Hello, and welcome to Demystifying Medicine. In this video, we will be talking about atherosclerosis and exploring how the immune system has a part to play in this disease. First, let's talk about some background information on atherosclerosis.
Atherosclerosis refers to the thickening or hardening of the arteries caused by a buildup of plaque. Plaque is a fatty, waxy substance that forms deposits in the artery walls.
Next, let's take a look at the mechanism of the disease by using a diagram to understand how it progresses over time. Atherosclerosis begins with damage occurring to the inner layer of the artery wall. The layer is called the intima. The intima is lined with endothelial cells forming the endothelium. The endothelium serves as a barrier between the blood and the artery wall. Damage to the endothelium can occur from high levels of cholesterol, various toxins, and high blood pressure from extended periods. Once the damage occurs, cholesterol from the blood gathers at the site and becomes oxidized, which triggers an immune response. The immune response causes white blood cells to travel to the area and form an inflammation. Following this, a fatty streak is one of the first visible signs of the disease. It is formed from dead cells at the injury site. It is formed by the white blood cells, also called monocytes, turning into macrophages. Macrophages will surround and kill any invading cell. The macrophages will consume the cholesterol in this case and become foam cells, which get their name from their foamy appearance. After the consumption of cholesterol, the foam cells will die and more white blood cells are sent to the area as a response. This cycle continues and the endothelium is damaged even more. The dead cells will form a bulge under the endothelium, referred to as the fatty streak. The process of forming more dead foam cells will continue, and other debris will continue building at the site of the fatty streak, causing it to become a large piece of plaque. The artery's smooth muscle cells will form a layer on top of the plaque called a fibrous cap, which covers the plaque and prevents it from breaking off into the bloodstream. The plaque continues to grow and can use calcium to harden. This growth will occur outward, restricting blood flow even more. Eventually, the plaque will rupture. This is done when the fibrous cap breaks open and the plaque comes into contact with the blood. This can cause a blood clot to form and will block blood flow, which can lead to a heart attack or stroke.
Let's move on to symptoms of atherosclerosis. Symptoms may vary depending on which arteries are affected. The coronary arteries supply blood to the heart. Symptoms of atherosclerosis in the coronary arteries include angina, which is chest pain, shortness of breath, and arrhythmias, which is abnormal heartbeat. The carotid arteries supply blood to the brain. Symptoms include weakness, paralysis or numbness in the face, arms, or legs, confusion, breathing problems, dizziness, and sudden and severe headache. The peripheral arteries supply blood to the legs, arms, and pelvis. Symptoms include numbness and pain in those areas. Lastly, the renal arteries supply blood to the kidneys. Symptoms include fatigue, changes in how often you urinate, loss of appetite, nausea, and itchiness or numbness.
There are some risk factors for atherosclerosis. These may look familiar to many, as the biggest risk factor overall is being unhealthy. Being overweight can lead to increased risk for atherosclerosis. Also, old age and diabetes can be risk factors as well. Some preventative measures you can take to try and avoid this disease is engaging in consuming a healthy diet, engaging in physical activity, and also not participating in smoking.
Now that we have provided an overview of atherosclerosis, let's talk about the immune system's involvement. Here are some of the key immune system players that are involved in the disease. Macrophages are resident cells in the blood vessels that get rid of disease-causing agents through a process called phagocytosis. These cells quite literally eat up the substance, which in this case is the cholesterol. Helper T cells are part of the adaptive immune system, and they can recognize specific substances and are activated against them. Once activated, these cells migrate to the area of injury and help activate other cells to fight against the disease-causing agent. Finally, cytokines are small molecules that are released by white blood cells to attract other white blood cells to the area of injury. Let's once again look at what's happening in the blood vessel. Low-density lipoproteins, or LDLs, are small fatty proteins that circulate in the blood. When they accumulate under the endothelial layer, they become oxidized. This starts the immune response by binding to specialized receptors on macrophages. These cells then remove the LDLs by phagocytosis. In atherosclerosis, LDL accumulation is often too much for the macrophages to handle. So, as a cry for help, they release cytokines which cause inflammation to occur. These cytokines leave a trail of breadcrumbs for white blood cells to follow to reach the site of inflammation, in this case, the arterial endothelium. This is where the helper T cells come in. They enter into the blood vessels and help activate other immune cells that try to reduce the LDL accumulation. Additionally, T cells further increase the inflammation in the blood vessels. Inflammation is the primary cause for the worsening of atherosclerosis because it can lead to plaques being ruptured. When this occurs, blood clots can form and can lead to thrombosis, which is the blocking of blood vessels. Consequently, there is a high risk for heart attacks and strokes to occur. Adaptive immune cells are highly involved in autoimmune conditions, which are conditions where your own body's immune cells are attacking healthy cells. It can be seen that the recruitment of helper T cells that attack your own body's endothelium causes an autoimmune reaction. Thus, it can be said that atherosclerosis is a kind of autoimmune condition.
There are a few treatments that we will talk about in the video. The first being cardiac catheterization and angioplasty. This is a surgical procedure where they place a stent, which is like a little balloon on a string, through the femoral artery in your leg up into the affected artery. They then inflate that balloon, causing the blood to have more room to flow through the artery. The second idea I want to talk about has to do with the immune system. So B1 lymphocytes are cells that our immune system makes, and these cells actually help prevent atherosclerosis. But B2 lymphocytes actually make this condition worse, because they recruit lots of immune cells to the site of blockage, which then causes more blockage. So there's ongoing research about how to tweak the immune system in increasing B1 lymphocytes, but not B2.
So now you can see that atherosclerosis, a disease largely thought of as just a heart condition, is so much more than that. It is also an autoimmune disease. Through this video, we hope that you have gained some valuable insight on atherosclerosis and can appreciate how the immune system plays a part in diseases such as this. Thank you for watching, and be sure to subscribe to Demystifying Medicine McMaster.